from Carnegie Mellon University, then also did a postdoc at Brown University. We worked with very big names, worked on very interesting fundamental problems. Got a few awards as well, ICTM, as far as I remember, delivered tutorials on these subjects as well. And his general area is in the sphere of big data, graph mining, and data mining and more generally. Welcome, Charalampos.
Thanks so much. Thank you, Dimitri. It's a pleasure to be here. So today I'm going to talk about a new work titled as Optimal Learning of Joint Alignments. So I would like to start by saying a few introductory words. Graphs, we know that they're a very important structure. Part of the reason why this is very important is because many data sets can be naturally modeled as graphs. So the World Wide Web, the internet, social networks, they can all be naturally modeled as graphs. Even our brain can be thought of as a graph structure where nodes correspond to neurons and edges to synapses. And there's a big project both in US and Europe to essentially create this graph out of medical images of the brain. Airline networks can be modeled as graphs, and of course images in computer vision are analyzed. One standard technique is to impose a grid structure on the top of this image, and weights on the edges are defined according to some similarity criterion between pixels. But let me say that images are also involved in a different type of graphs. Specifically, there exist huge graphs where every node corresponds to an image, and you have an edge between two images if those images are similar according to some criterion. So for instance, you can think that when you use Google Images and try to say search similar image as your input, there is some kind of search in a huge similarity graph. Okay, so in addition to these data sets that are naturally modeled as graphs, graphs come up in different settings as well. So this is what I call graphs from probing. And I have two examples here. The first one is related to a classic database problem known as entity resolution. So entity resolution is the problem of finding all records in a database that refer to the same entity. So for instance, think that your database consists of images. You may want to find all images that belong to the same person. This problem has been a central problem in databases for decades, but in the last years, due to new technologies, relatively new technologies now, like Amazon Mechanical Turk and other crowdsourcing platforms, there's been a new approach to this entity resolution problem. Specifically, suppose you want to resolve this problem, what you can do is you can hire workers on Amazon Mechanical Turk, and you can ask them, you can give them two records in your database, and you can ask them, do these two records refer to the same entity? So you get an answer. So what is going on here? You have these N items, these N records, and essentially when you give to a worker a given pair of records, you are testing an edge. You're probing an edge. You're getting an answer about a pairwise relationship between these two records. So here you can see, for instance, I have a small example of two different US actresses. The one is Keira Knightley, and the other one, another famous one. They look pretty similar. They're two different. So one thing is that you may get noisy answers. You may get answers that are not always correct. It can be sometimes difficult to resolve these questions. So one thing is, at the first level, I want to say that here you have an items and you create the graph. You choose which pairs to query and you get answers and you have a graph that you decided to create. it's essentially a subgraph of the complete graph, and somehow you want to resolve this issue by also asking as few queries as possible in this setting. In the second case, you can see a protein-protein interaction graph. Actually, the red dots correspond to HIV proteins. And the graph consists of roughly 1,500 edges. So it's a small graph, but nonetheless, creating this graph is a very tedious task. So to test whether, let's say, two entities from this graph interact or not, it involves experiments, biological experiments. It involves PhDs, personnel, highly trained personnel. It involves equipment, and also there is, again, noise. So nonetheless, again, we decide which pairs of proteins, let's say, to test. We create a graph by doing experiments, okay? So today I'm going to talk mainly graphs from probing, and actually for a very specific type of graphs that we create, which are also directed in a sense. So what I'm going to talk about, as I said, it's recent work. The paper is online on archive since September, and it's collaboration with Kasper Green Larsen from the University of Aarhus and Michael Mitzenmacher from Harvard University. So I would like to start by introducing formally the problem that we're going to focus on. It's called joint alignments. It's a problem that comes up in computer vision. So we have n unknown variables, G0 up to G of n minus 1. And every variable takes one out of k possible values. So it's convenient to think of these k possible values as zk. So we're going to do arithmetic modulo k. So let me draw. Does this work? No? Oh, you don't have? Okay. Okay. So is there any marker, or maybe I can? It's okay. It's okay. Don't worry. So think of it as a clock, okay? So we have k states. For example, here it's 12. And we label them from 0 up to k minus 1. Okay? So we don't know those values of those variables. So we describe them as a latent function g that maps those n items to k possible states. So for instance, in this toy example, if this is my first item, g of 0 is 5. Okay. So we will think of these n unknown variables corresponding to n nodes. GU is going to be thought as a cluster ID that corresponds to node U. Is this clear as a setting? Okay, to have this unknown function that we wish to learn. Now, what is the model? The model is we choose which pairs of items to query. And what we are able to get is a noisy measurement of the difference of the IDs. So intuitively, what I would like you to think as an application is, if you go to this case, suppose I have pictures of mine looking in this angle, in this angle, in this angle, and so on. So think of a discretization of the 360 degrees, and this discretization will naturally correspond to these k states, okay? So what you can do essentially is you decide to choose a pair of items, a pair of pictures, let's say, and what you are able to get is a noisy measurement of their pairwise difference. Angle difference, in this case, cluster ID difference. I can repeat it, there is no issue. No worries. So as I said, the problem is the following. We have this unknown function G, which maps n items to k states. We think of those k states as arranged modulo k. So we're going to do arithmetic modulo k. So think of the states on a clock, labeled from 0 up to k minus 1 for convenience. So this is zk. Let's call it zk. And what we can do is we can choose any pair of items that we wish from those n items. And what we are obtaining is a noisy measurement of the pairwise difference, modulo k. So as I said, the motivating application is to think that I have a set of images or shapes that are, you have taken them pictures in different angles. So think of a discretization of 360 degrees, and these naturally correspond to the k-states, okay? So what you're able to get is essentially a noisy measurement of their pairwise difference of angle, modulo k. So I'm using two slides from a professor in Princeton, Chen, who has, yes. Yeah, of course. One more. So there is no, and this will be even visually shown in the next images. So I'm using, as I said, Chen and Candes have the prior state of the art on this problem, and I'm using a couple of slides from Chen. They visualize the problem very nicely. So as I said, think of the following application. Suppose this is your input. The problem is you want to align those images. And what you can do is, for every pair of items that you choose, you can get a noisy measurement of the relative angle of those items. But there is noise involved. And the goal is to find all items that have a specific angle towards a reference point. So there is no ordering. There is no ranking here. It's just that all items that belong to a certain angle, in our case, we think discretized setting, in a certain state, they have to, you have to find this cluster, essentially. So it's a clustering problem in computer vision. Okay, so as we said, we have k groups. We number them from 0 to k minus 1. We will be doing arithmetic modulo k. So these are the possible remainders. We have the cluster IDs that we don't know. And we have the following model. We can choose to query a certain pair of nodes. X, Y, and what we're getting is a noisy measurement of their pairwise difference. So the noise is modeled through a variable eta XY. The noise is IID. So when you query XY, it's independent from the rest, and I will tell you the distribution of this modulo K. And without any loss of generality, the noise is supported on those values. If you had a value exceeding this, modulo k would map to these values. So the problem is, and let me also add that you can query a certain edge only once, okay? So the idea is that if you query it multiple times, you will get the same measurement. So the problem is you want to recover g with high probability, exactly, with as few measurements as possible and as fast as possible. So you care about the query complexity and the running time. And I will tell you in the next slide what is the model for the noise, the probabilistic model. So this with high probability means that as the number of nodes goes to infinity, you want to be able to find G with probability that goes to 1. So is the problem clear to everyone? Okay. And also, let me say that if you query x, y, and then you query y, x, you get essentially the additive inverse. So it gives you no new information. Once you choose a pair, you get one noisy number of this pairwise difference. So the noise between those two queries is the same. It's just, you know, you ask the relative angle between x and y. If you ask for y, x, you will get 360 degrees minus this. That's the idea. So is the model clear to everyone? What is
why does this symmetric argument hold always?
Not always. In this in the model, this is in the assumptions of the model. That perhaps in certain applications you can relax this constraint, and we could in principle. But here I'm going to discuss this case. Okay. So essentially, when you query x y, you get one number. Doesn't matter the order of y x. You will get one noisy measurement of their pairwise cluster IDs.
If you compare two entities, and one entity certainly comes, you know, with its own context, not only the features of that entity that are listed on the node, but taking, let's say, the relation in this respect.
Yeah, this is different. Yeah. So this is the problem, and let me tell you now the actual probability distribution of the noise. So we're going to consider the following noise. So let me make an observation. If the noise was zero, let's say, if the probability that the noise is zero is one, so it's always zero, then recovering G is trivial. Of course, there is some cyclic offset that you will never be able to recover, because if you look the set of variables, let's say G of X, if you set for every X G of X, the correct value, or if you set G of X minus one, so you shift the IDs by one modulo K, the relative differences will remain the same. So there is some cyclic offset that we cannot recover, but it doesn't matter to us. As you ask me, we don't care about the ordering. We just want to recover the K clusters. Okay, so now we're going to take it to the extreme. So what do I mean by this? So as I said, if the probability that the noise is zero is one, then the problem is trivial. So what we're going to do is we're going to assume that the probability that the noise is zero is a little bit above uniform. So if you have K cluster IDs, if delta was zero, then you have no chance of recovering G. You have just random answers. So we're going to assume that there is a small bias towards the correct difference. Okay, so the probability that you get the right answer is a little bit above uniform. Okay, and this is parameterized by this delta, which is a positive parameter. And what about the rest of the values? For the rest of the values, I'm going to discuss the case here where it's uniform among them. So with the remaining probability, you take a uniform noise value between 1 up to k minus 1. Is this clear as a distribution? Okay. So we're going to delta, let me say that it's not necessarily a constant. It could depend on n, it could depend on k. So it's something that could be tending to zero as n goes to infinity. And we want to see how many queries do we need and how fast can we recover g. What is possible? So we're going to discuss both lower bounds and upper bounds. Okay? And yes, question? So it naturally models our belief that our measurements are better than random guesses. That's what it models. And we're just modeling it in this way to take it to the extreme. We want to see what happens as we get closer to just having random guesses. But yes, we do believe that there is some bias towards the right answer, the right pairwise difference.
The belief is based on some
application. Yeah, exactly. So we're going to choose which pairs X and Y to query in a non-adaptive way. So at this point, I need to distinguish adaptive and non-adaptive. So a non-adaptive algorithm in this setting decides which queries to perform beforehand. And then once you have your answers, your algorithm runs and produces some kind of output. In the adaptive case, your algorithm may look into the answers of previous queries and decide to do different queries depending on those answers. So I'm going to discuss non-adaptive case today. So bottom line, now I'm done with the definition of the problem, is that we have those n items. They belong to k clusters, which we think of as arranged modulo k. In arithmetic modulo k, zk, we're able to choose which pairs to query. For every pair, we get a noisy measurement of the pairwise difference of the cluster IDs. And we want from those noisy measurements to recover G up to certain cyclic offset. And what we care about is the query complexity and the running time. That's a problem. This is a joint alignment problem. So one can start by writing down the maximum likelihood estimate of this problem and trying to solve this optimization problem. It's a discrete problem. As we said from the beginning, our variables are G of phi for any I is a number between 0 up to k minus 1. So we have a discrete problem, and it's a non-convex problem. So this is a quick remark. And before I give you our algorithm and our results, I would like to first discuss a little bit the related work. So for there's going to be two cases here. And the one is when k is equal to 2. So you have only two clusters. This is a very important special case because it reduces to a clustering problem, which is pretty well studied. So practically, let me make a small Venn diagram that I have in the slides later. So when k equals 2, the joint alignment and clustering, they share this special case, k equals 2. So I'm going to discuss this. So for k equals 2, let's suppose for convenience that our function g maps nodes to minus 1 and plus 1 instead of 0, 1. It's going to be more convenient to define what I want. Let's say the nodes that go to minus 1 red, and apologize, there should be g here. It's from another slide. And let's say the blue one are the nodes that are mapped to plus 1. We can define tau uv to be the product of gu times gv. So it's plus 1 whenever whenever u and v belong to the same cluster, and minus 1 if they belong to different clusters. Simple observation. So now what I'm going to define as the noise measurement in more convenient terms here is that, again, you can query a pair of nodes, u, v, and you get a noisy measurement of the true sign between u and v. And we call this noisy sign tau tilde, u, v. So it's the true sign gu times gv times the noise, eta uv, where eta uv is plus minus 1. So if it's minus 1, it flips the correct sign between u and v. That's the noise. And the expectation is delta. Equivalently, you can think of this model as you choose your pair, u, v. You ask an oracle. This is like your instruments that give you some kind of measurement. And you get the correct answer of whether u and v belong to the same cluster with probability 1 half plus delta over 2, that I call also 1 minus q. You can see this because if you take, let's say, 1 half plus delta over 2, if you take the expectation of this thing times plus 1 plus minus 1 times 1 half minus delta over 2, this is the expected value of eta xy, is exactly delta. So the two models are equivalent. And the problem here in this special case is, again, you want to recover g with as few queries as possible with high probability. This is exactly what I said. So this is the way things look. I had worked first in this problem and then in this problem, and the intersection of these two problems is when k is equal to 2. Okay? So for the special case k equals 2, there exists a lot of work. One way to attack the problem when you look at the maximum likelihood. How many of you have heard correlation clustering? Okay, so it's a very important formulation of clustering, and the idea is that you define, when you have a cluster, you can have, we define a disagreement to be a negative edge inside the same cluster or a positive edge that leaves the cluster. Intuitively, you would like to have pluses inside and minus outside. So the correlation clustering, the minimizing the disagreements formulation, is specifically you want to partition the graph into clusters. The nice thing about correlation clustering, you don't need to give the number of clusters as part of the input. The method learns what is the right number of clusters. The only thing you care about is trying to minimize the number of disagreements. So this is an NP-hard problem. Bansal, et al., Bloom, and Chola studied this problem initially, And since then, a lot of work has followed. There is an excellent survey by Francesco Bonchi and others in 2014, for those interested. Still, even if it's like 5 years, still pretty valuable. And Mathieu and Shudi studied a version of noisy correlation clustering that requires complete information and is able to recover clusters when they are their size is at least root them asymptotically. So in the case of, yes, question? Yes, they're scalable. Yeah, there exist algorithms that are pretty scalable. There exist certain algorithms that, let's say, may use SDPs, and you cannot hope to scale them to really massive graphs. But there exist algorithms which are pretty. One of them is by Alon called Quick Cluster. So yes, correlation clustering is a practical solution to cluster. Yeah, it does scale. So. Another very related model is the planted partition model that I'm going to discuss how it's connected to our problem. You have two groups of nodes, and a graph is generated by essentially for every pair inside the cluster, you toss a coin with probability P. If you succeed, you add an edge. If not, you don't add an edge. And the coin between two different clusters is Q. And to capture the clustering structure, you assume that Q is less than P. That's a model. So you generate the graph, but you don't know the clusters. I just give you the graph, and now you need to recover them. That's a planned partition model in the most basic version with two clusters. And this is also a very well-studied problem. And there's a lot of work. As you can see, if the two clusters are balanced, then we can recover the clusters with high probability under certain conditions. And also it has been studied from an information theoretic perspective. So the question is, why is this related to our problem? Well, for a second, suppose let me write a few things here. So suppose, as I said, in the case of our problem, you can query any pair that you like. You get a plus, you get a minus. So you get the correct answer with probability 1/2 plus delta over 2, and the wrong answer with 1/2 minus delta over 2. So for a moment, suppose you only look the positive edges. So you made your queries, and your oracle told you this set of pairs belong to the same cluster. Let's look only those set of pairs that the oracle said that they belong to the same cluster. So only the what we got from the oracle and was plus. Let's forget for a moment the minus edge. So when can we have a plus edge? We get a plus edge if it was the correct answer, and we get this with probability 1/2 plus delta over 2. So we will get some pluses from edges inside the clusters with this probability. And we will get negative edges when we get wrong answers between across the two clusters with probability 1/2 minus delta over 2. So if you look the graph with the positive edges, it's like having a graph with P equal to this and Q equal to this. So it looks like a planned partition model. So if you have certain constraints on the size of the clusters and certain other constraints, then you can hope to recover the graph, the clusters. But we're going to discuss the more general setting. Also, Hayek and others have extensions of this on signed graphs that use SDPs, which are not scalable solution as we like. Plus, they have certain cardinality constraints on the clusters. There's a lot of, let's say, research lines that could be used to attack this problem. Another one, you can think of this problem as a matrix completion problem. The main issue if you use those techniques is that you cannot tolerate big imbalance. So specifically, if you have, let's say, a bunch of clusters, in our case, let's say two, and one of them is very small, this parameter gamma is going to be very large. Okay, so these measures how imbalanced the two clusters are in size. And the number of queries you would require is this gamma to the fourth n log square n. And of course, you can always get that gamma fourth n log square n is at most n square. So you can see that you cannot tolerate any type of imbalance. Pretty much the clusters have to be balanced. If you do the algebra, you will get a bound on the imbalance. There was a paper in NIPS 2 years ago by Mazumdar and Saha that studied this problem for k equals 2. And they gave a polynomial time algorithm that used n log n over delta to the fourth queries. And with Michael, Casper, Jarek, Ben, Vasilis, and Pritum, we improved this algorithm by essentially giving a polynomial time algorithm that, except for very tiny delta, it achieves n log n over delta squared queries and in polynomial time. So that's how the landscape of related work is. So now, in terms of the joint alignment problem, so now we go to the case where k is greater or equal than 3. So the two problems deviate. The state of the art was due to Chen and Candes, who consider a similar setting as ours. So the problem formulation is the same. And they propose a projected power method to solve this non-convex optimization problem. And they prove that, actually provably, it gives you the right G with high probability. So specifically, they formulate the problem, they relax the problem, and they formulate it as a constraint PCA problem. And they show that by essentially doing some kind of gradient descent and then projecting back to the simplex, you get with high probability the correct function G when the queries you have performed, so that's the setting they considered, they form an Erdos-Reinig graph. So as I said in the beginning, you have those n items, you choose the queries to make. The queries they made was uniform. So you essentially probe a pair xy with probability p. And p is roughly log n over n. So you are at the connectivity threshold. Pretty much. I'm skipping some technical details here. So their algorithm is non-adaptive, as I said. The underlying queries form a random binomial graph. So they decide beforehand, as I said, which queries to perform. They form this random graph, and then they actually prove that you need, in this case, n log n over k delta square queries to be able to recover G. If you perform less than this number of queries, then you cannot recover G. For this special case, when the queries form a random binomial graph, we will prove that this actually holds not only for random binomial graphs, but for any non-adaptive algorithm. They give an algorithm whose query complexity matches this lower bound. So practically, they solve it optimally as well. And before that, I was interested in improving certain aspects of applicability and runtime of this algorithm. I was studying this problem earlier with Michael, and we had some results. We had designed an algorithm I'm going to say a few words about that used only breadth-first search, but the results were inferior to Chen Candes' algorithm. So specifically, that was the older result. We had an algorithm that more or less performed n to the exponent of 1 plus this term queries and was able to recover g for any delta constant. So it was much weaker, but was a step towards trying to getting a different algorithm. It turns out that a simpler algorithm is going to be optimal. So in this work with Casper and Michael, we were able to prove the following theorem. So for delta being extremely small, So that's how we characterize this range of biases. So if delta satisfies these constraints, and we look at the regime for where the number of clusters is sublinear, then we design a non-adaptive algorithm that makes n log n over delta square over k queries. So one interesting thing you can see, the dependence on the number of clusters is inverse. So the more clusters you have, you can do less queries. And runs in n log n over delta square times k time, and is correct with high probability. We also looked into different ranges of the bias delta, and what changes is the expression for the query complexity, and the runtime is linear in the queries, practically speaking. So this is our main result. Yes?
The bias in the denominator, makes sense. If it's more bias, less queries, let's say.
If it's more queries. The bias, yeah? If the bias is small, then you have to make...
Yes, if it's higher bias...
Yeah, less queries, yeah.
The clusters are doing
that. Yes, that's part of the surprising thing about this problem, that the dependence on K is inverse. So the more clusters you have, the less queries you need to perform. So I will show you the algorithm, and you will see how you get this. Yes?
I guess I'm trying to see.
Yeah. I'll get to the end and yes. So for this one, I haven't talked about which graph. I will tell you the algorithm in a second. So once I tell you the algorithm, you will see. And perhaps you'll get some intuition behind the dependence on K. So the reason why you get this, like at least from a technical point of view, is we use certain probabilistic analysis on Chernoff bounds, and I think, so if you do the clustering version, where you just ask whether two nodes belong to the same cluster or not, then K appears here, in the denominator. In our case, we get much more information. We get these, we don't just get if they belong or not to the same cluster, we get much more information about their differences of the cluster IDs that we can exploit to learn G with less queries than the clustering version. So in terms of, so now I will also describe a matching lower bound. So practically what I'm saying is that among non-adaptive algorithms, our result is optimal up to, let's say, constants. The number of queries that you need to perform, specifically prove if you perform less than this number of queries asymptotically, then the success probability is upper bounded by this term over there. So you need, this is something that was known when the queries form a random binomial graph, but it actually holds for any non-adaptive algorithm. That's what we prove. Any non-adaptive algorithm needs to perform n log n over delta square times k queries. And as I said, if you go to larger biases, the only thing that changes is the expression of the number of queries. And this arises from the probabilistic analysis and the form of the Chernoff bounds that we use. So now we'll answer your question about the graph. So I'm going to describe the algorithm for the range of small bias. So we need n log n over k delta square queries. So the first step of the algorithm is the following. You choose an arbitrary set S of nodes, anything you like, and you perform all queries between S and the rest of the nodes. So you can immediately see that the number of queries is going to be this times this, so it's going to be order n log n over k delta square. So you perform those queries, and then one step that is convenient, at least, is to choose an arbitrary node within S and set its ID to be zero. Think of it as a grounding operation. We say, we don't know this cyclic offset, so we take one node and we just assign it zero. That's where we lose this cyclic offset. So now, the third step is going to be the following. We want to, in the third step, we're going to learn all those pairwise differences between any pair of nodes, practically in S, correctly. So how do we do this? So this node, we have set its ID to be 0, okay? And we want to learn an estimate for the cluster ID of S prime. So we're going to estimate the ID of this by thinking of paths of length 2 from S prime to S. So specifically, we will think that every node B inside this set is casting a vote with respect to what the ID of G of S prime is. And the reason is the following. So let me draw something here on the blackboard for a second. So when you have S prime and you perform this query to B, you get G of S prime minus G of B modulo K plus noise. Let's assume the noise was 0. And then you get from this pair S G of B minus G of S modulo K. So when you add them up, you get the right pairwise difference. Okay? So in expectation, things look reasonable. So now what we're going to do, every B will give you essentially a vote on this pairwise difference by taking the sum of those two queries. So what we're going to do, for every B, we're going to get a number. This number is going to be some number between 0 and k minus 1. So we're going to have a vector, pretty much, that has entries supported in this interval. We're going to get the plurality vote among those numbers. So the one that appears the most, we call it plurality because we can have more than two numbers. Typically, if it's two, we call it majority. Here we have more than two. And this is going to be our estimate, pretty much, for G of S. And I'm saying pretty much because we have grounded G of S, otherwise we would have to take care of that. So G of S is 0, and we learn G of S prime to be this plurality vote among those numbers. Is this clear as a step? So this step actually learns correctly everything inside S. So we're able to learn the cluster. So in the analysis, we're able to prove that for any S prime, we learn G of S prime with high enough probability. And from there, once we have this, what we're going to do, think of S now as a seed. We're going to take any node U, which is not in S. We're going to query it towards all nodes in S. So we're going to do N log n over k delta square queries again. And what we're going to do is something very similar. Every difference here is going to give me a vote on what g of u is, and I'm going to take the plurality vote. So we're going to say g of e. G of s, as I said, is like something grounded. G of s is the cluster ID of node s, plus the query is going to be my estimate for u from any given node here. The plurality is going to give me the correct answer. Okay, so essentially this is the intuition, that you have this bias that is biasing you towards the right answer. This algorithm is very easy to implement and actually is optimal for this problem. This just expresses what I've said in figures, in words. So let me now tell you a couple of things about these lower bounds. So specifically, these two results, we proved them in order to prove the lower bound. They were very useful in proving the lower bound. I'm assuming that many of you are familiar with Chernoff bounds. Chernoff bounds are used for proving concentration of measure. Here we want to prove anti-concentration. So when you have, let's say, let me say just... How many of you are familiar with Chernoff bounds? Okay, let me say something quick about this. So if you have, let's say, coin tosses, okay, we all know that if the coin is fair, after we perform N coin tosses, we're not going to be far away from the average. So actually, This is something taught in undergraduate probability, that under certain conditions, the binomial can be approximated by the Gaussian. So the probability of deviating from the mean has exponential tails. The probability drops exponentially as you move far away from the mean. On the other hand, the question is, this is the probability of deviating from the mean. The question is, what is the probability that you have exactly half of the coin tosses equal to heads and half to tails? This probability is not large, okay? It's the sum of those probabilities within an interval that make it large. So the bottom line is, in anti-concentration, instead of trying to prove the probability of deviating from the mean is small, we're trying to prove the other way around. We're trying to prove lower bounds on this probability. So how close can we be to the mean is lower bounded by some probability. Is this clear? So, good. So the lemma says the following. If we have, let's say, k be an integer and delta satisfies this range, and we have iid random variables where xi takes value 1 with probability 1 over k plus delta, and the value minus 1 with probability 1 over k minus delta over k minus 1, and the value 0 otherwise, this corresponds naturally to our setting. Okay, so the probability that the noise is 0 is 1 over k plus delta. So now what we're going to look is this value of the noise versus any other value of the noise. So if you remember in the probabilistic model, let's say I want to see if the vote, the correct vote, let's say, when noise is 0, will appear more times than any other value I. So what is the probability that noise is I, when I is not 0, is 1 over k minus delta over k minus 1. So that's what we're doing. So we're looking the probability that the noise is 0 versus I, and we're going to do this for every different possible value of I. So this maps to plus 1, this maps to minus 1, the rest map to 0. So we're going to see if this dominates this. So the probability that the sum of the xi's is negative, in this case, when is this negative? It's negative when this value appears more often than plus 1. That's when it's negative. The probability that this is negative is upper bounded by these two expressions. So here we have concentration, and here we have anti-concentration. So the probability of deviating from the expectation, in a way, is upper bounded by something exponential. But on the other hand, this probability is also lower bounded asymptotically by the same expression. So this bound is pretty tight for this probability of deviation. Okay. So this is concentration. This is like Chernoff bounds. This is anti-concentration. Okay. So on the one hand, this says that the probability that we get the wrong answer is upper bounded by this. But on the other hand, we get a lower bound on this probability as well. It cannot be 0, let's say. It's lower bounded by this. Is this clear as a statement? Because it's perhaps of independent interest. It's like an expression that perhaps someone can use in a similar concentration of measure result. And what changes when the range of delta changes is the form of those bounds. Without going into the details, that's what you get. When delta changes, the expressions of these exponents in the Chernoff bound become what you can see in this theorem. So I think we have 5 minutes or... Okay, so let me quickly say the old result. So the old result performs queries like the Chen-Candesa algorithm. As I said, it's suboptimal. It performs more queries than Chen-Candesa, but let me give you the idea. The idea is that if I want to find the sign between X and Y, we perform those queries randomly. This creates a random binomial graph. In this random binomial graph, since it's a random graph, we can prove nice things about it. We can actually show the existence of a specific subgraph This was a technique I worked with my PhD advisor during my dissertation. So you can prove that you have a subgraph that looks as follows. So X has a tree rooted in it, let's call it T of X, and Y similarly a tree rooted on Y. The branching factor, you can think of these trees, is think of delta as constant for now, is like order log n. Actually, it's what you see there. These trees are not disjoint. The depth of the trees is carefully chosen. So it's not really long. It's like short depth, short enough to have small dependencies between the paths, and long enough to create enough leaves. Between those trees, there is a natural isomorphism between the leaves, and you can create edge disjoint paths of length roughly log n over log n. So the expression here appears because this is the diameter of this graph in this asymptotic regime. You can actually prove that an Erdős-Reinick graph in the connectivity threshold has asymptotically this diameter. That's where this comes from, these expressions come from. Once we create this structure, as I said, yes?
Sorry to interrupt. Is that conventional because I need to leave?
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you something. If you, I think we don't talk about the adaptive, but if you query both the adaptive and the non-adaptive with increasing n, can you draw some conclusion about your bias?
The adaptive and the non-adaptive.
With increasing increasing number of queries,
yes.
And you see the difference in the G between the
yeah.
two. Can you draw some conclusion about the bias that exists in the problem?
So I haven't talked at all about adaptive, and adaptive is actually less well studied. One of the open problems I want to say is about adaptive. So we have certain knowledge that in certain regimes, let's say when cluster sizes are pretty much the same and under certain other constraints of the parameters, this is something we already know, is that you don't get any power from the adaptive ones compared to the non-adaptive ones. So the comparison here, it's, but in principle, like resolving whether adaptive algorithms can give you something better is something pretty interesting, yeah. So let me quickly say that these trees have branching factor log n, except for the first level that has log n over delta to the L. This subgraph essentially gives you a path from X to Y, gives you many paths, as many as the leaves. So every path, you have numbers on these edges, which are the numbers you got from your queries. If you sum them up, you get a vote. Every path gives a vote. And then if you take the majority vote, the plurality vote among those, then you get an estimate. And this, under certain conditions, is the correct with high probability for all pairs. That's the idea of the algorithm. So I'm describing this for k equals 2, but it generalized for k greater than 3. I will say how. So the proof sketch for the subgraph construction, I won't have time to go over it, but it uses just breadth first search. And there is a key lemma that proves that this subgraph exists within the graph that you create from your queries. So specifically, you can, for any pair of nodes x, y, you can create the subgraph with two regular trees rooted at x, y, with specific branching factors, with a large enough number of leaves that are connected by edge disjoint paths of length L, roughly. So when k equals 2, the probability that the, so when k equals 2, remember, we, in the most general case, we get plus minus 1, okay? So we get whether the two nodes are in the same class or not. So if we take, let's say, the product of the signs, the probability that the product of the signs give you the correct answer, so the probability that you get 1 if they belong to the same cluster, or minus 1 if they belong to the different cluster, is 1 plus delta to the power of L over 2. You can see as L increases, this delta over L goes to 0 because delta is less than 1. So the question is, why would you like to do this? The reason is, as you give yourself freedom for greater L, you allow yourself to create more paths. So the technical analysis works on finding the right trade-off between those two things. So I won't go through this detail. I would like to tell you the algorithm. Every path, they're not disjoint paths, because when you have X and you have, let's say, these paths, let's say this path goes from X to Y, and this path, they share this edge. So these votes are no longer independent random variables. Let's say they share this edge here. So you get the sum, you get from every path a vote, you take the plurality vote when k is greater or equal than 3, and this gives you the correct answer. The analysis relies on analyzing the following. So if you look the path from X to Y, and you look the answers you got from your oracle on those differences, and you sum them up, you get the true difference plus some random variables. And the question is, when is this sum of random variables equals to zero? So to analyze this, you analyze a simple Markov chain on a cycle. So without going into the details, if this, for the simple case where a simpler model that I can write on this blackboard, if, let's say, the right difference is here, and you assume you get the correct difference with probability 1 minus q, or you get q over half for the neighboring ones, the matrix looks like this, and you can analyze the eigenvectors of this matrix. You can find the desired gaps, and pretty much that's how the analysis goes. It analyzes certain types of random walks on these cycles. So preliminary, this is my last slide. I would like to say that there are some preliminary experimental results that actually, bottom line, they show that our method is very, besides being very easy to implement, it's also very practical. We have compared it to Chen Candes. I don't have many details about experimental settings here. The bottom line of what we've observed so far is that, for instance, you can see here, we set, let's say, the number of clusters, the biases to certain values, and we study the scalability. Chen Candes actually doesn't scale. It's pretty slow. And our method, we observe that it takes only a few seconds for tens of thousands of nodes. Unfortunately, we cannot compare because Chen Candes stops at roughly this range of n on a simple machine. Our method scales pretty well, as you can see by the algorithm. One key question is whether we can design adaptive algorithms with better query complexity. And I would like to finish. Tomorrow is my son's birthday, so I want to say happy birthday to him. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take them. Thanks so much.
So just a quick question. We know that you also have your work also has practical implications, like graph libraries integrated into Windows Azure. Is there any window for applying this in a specific application domain? What exactly is the scenario behind this?
So for specifically this problem, as I said in the beginning, I was working on the clustering version of the problem, and then I realized that this problem, when you change the model, you get this joint alignment. So this comes up in computer vision, which is not my primary focus of area. But so from an application perspective, it's not something that, you know, it's one of my applications that I focus on. But nonetheless, this theoretical result solves it optimally. So you get insights both from lower bounds and a very simple optimal algorithm that resolves it. So in terms of experiments, I've seen papers in this area that focus on computer vision and joint alignment of shapes or images. So that's something we want to look at. So let me say something about this question. So I think one of the main constraints of these models is the fact that you assume IID noise. I think that's the main issue with practical aspects of these models is that you have some very strong assumptions, which make sense from a theoretical perspective, that the noise is IID, but I mean, in reality, you don't expect the noise to be IID. Actually, in the crowdsourcing applications I discussed, there exist certain areas in the graph where the probability that you get the wrong answer is much higher, if, let's say, two faces that are very similar. So it's not just, you know, IID. I think that's the main constraint, but nonetheless, I think in many cases what happens is that once you get a solid algorithm, some of the ideas can even be used as heuristics or, let's say, practical approaches to even when the assumptions do not hold. This is something to be tested. We haven't looked into the real application of the joint alignment, just the theory. Yeah.
Thank you very much again.